where do you want the end of this country, please?
Number four.
This is number four, Beaumont Park Drive at Royden. It's Sunday, the 1st of April, 2001. Time approximately 10:35 a.m. This is the home of Michael Barrymore.
A 31-year-old Stuart Lubbock was found floating in the swimming pool at Mr. Barrymore's home in Essex. He died soon after.
Detectives are investigating the death, which happened after a party last night at Mr. Barrymore's home in Essex.
As one of Britain's most popular entertainers, Mr. Lubbock's death is sure to throw the media spotlight back on to the life and troubled times of Michael Barrymore.
There was no sex in that house that night. There was no orgy that I was aware of, at all.
For Essex Police, the death of Stuart Lubbock remains an unsolved murder.
This is very much still a live investigation. I believe that somebody at that party knows what happened. That is completely and utterly a fact.
I just hope they understand that it's just another night that went terribly wrong.
Late coach party.
Right! Excuse me. Hello? Wait, hey, hello. How are you? How are you, though? Yeah, where the bleeding have you been? Hey, what happened then?
Back in the traffic coming up.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Do what, lad?
I don't have problems this evening.
You've had enough problems without me. I'll fix all that.
Whoa, and the winner is Michael Barrymore.
Ladies and gentlemen, the 1999 Special Recognition Award goes to Mr. Michael Barrymore.
And of course, he's a fan favourite with theatre offices up and down the country.
Thank you very much. Thank you, what?
Have a nice night.
I do, thank you.
I'll be down in a second.
Okay, Doc.
Michael really was truly alive when he was on stage. He needed an audience, he needed to perform. He took risks, which gave him an edge that you don't associate with mainstream entertainment.
Oh, yes.
He went to dangerous places.
Oh, I can't believe this.
He was a precious asset for ITV, and ITV then was the biggest stage in Britain. So Michael was addressing the nation, entertaining the nation.
Michael!
His wife was his manager. She'd been an entertainer herself, she was a singer. So between them, they had a pretty clear idea about what entertained people, what made people smile. And it was not just the jokes and the routines, it was also emotional heart. Michael became so popular because the audience felt he was one of them.
What did you say?
I said, oh, God, you're handsome.
No, you didn't. You didn't say that.
I think he struggled when he wasn't performing, he wasn't working. There was a secret he held, and he held it from his family and from his wife.
In the mid-90s, everybody knew me on the circuit. Every Friday night, I was at the White Swan. I went on at 12 o'clock, regular clockwork. Just to pack out.
The lovely Dave Lee!
Yeah! I guess you hungry.
This particular night, I walked on stage, did my jokes, the place erupted, and I thought, it's not that funny. Wasn't that great a line? They were screaming. And I turned around and Michael Berrymore was behind me. He came forward and hugged me and said hello. He said, what have you got on your tape? He just sang everything that was on there. And we got to New York, New York. Before I could go any further, he said, I think I'm gay today. Took his ring off and threw it on the floor. The place just went mental. It just went, like, very, very happy place.
Other papers used to moan because the Sun always got phone calls. People would phone up with tips. Then often we would actually sit on the night news desk and in front of you was your phone, but it had about five different lines, which would obviously light up. And at night, you know, you might be lucky if you got a few on line one. And then all of a sudden this night, we sat there, the lights started flashing and going off. And normally that would be like, oh, a bomb's gone off or there's been a murder. But it was lots of gay men saying, guess what's just happened at the White Swan? You know, Michael Barrymore's got on and told everyone he's gay. I don't think we'd really had him down as being gay. So we dispatched a photographer and then waited, you know, to hear if this was actually true. Michael was there, drunk, but very happy. He said, I can't go on like this, and this is me. And I think it was a big relief for him.
Once all the brouhaha surrounding Michael Barrymore's show-stopping confession dies down, will it have moved public opinion on or back? According to the most recent survey, the public is still very conservative about sexual relations between adults of the same sex.
Michael Barrymore earned his massive popularity through interacting, or more accurately, fooling about with the British public. My kind of people, he says. The question is he still our kind of entertainer?
Being gay was still taboo. A big married family entertainer comes out and says, I'm gay. It's a big story. The trope of the tabloid back then was family does not equate with gay. Gay equates with nightclubs and rent boys and moral ambiguity. And it triggered a stampede of interest from the tabloids.
In the office, there was a sense that he'd been caught out. You know, a sense in those days, which would never happen now, that you could run loads and loads of negative stories on him. So the hunt was on for lovers and evidence of him, you know, misbehaving.
He was plagued by those people. But the vast majority of the public accepted him for who he was. His audience were way ahead of the tabloids. He was just as authentic to them.
This was Mr. Barrymore's first awards ceremony since he announced his homosexuality.
I've no regrets, he told people. My fans have been marvellous.
The winner is Michael Barrymore.
He won all three of the awards he was in for, including Most Popular Entertainment Presenter.
I'd like to say, it isn't what happens to you in your life, it's how you deal with it. And when you have the support and love of a nation, then no problem apart from death is unsolvable.
Police outside the house of Michael Barrymore, the scene of a tragic discovery at dawn today. The body of a young man found floating unconscious in the swimming pool at this private estate in the quiet Essex village of Royden.
I used to go into the News of the World every Saturday afternoon to see if I could pick up a big news event happening. Your initial reaction is, oh, bloody hell. One of the biggest entertainers in Britain with a body in his pool, it's just like, wow, that's just got News of the World all over it. I only really cared about getting stuff in the paper. Very rarely would you consider the feelings of anyone because your job was on the line. If you didn't get 12 exclusives every year, you'd get sacked. We were going to get the inside track, whatever it takes. And so pretty much everyone in the whole office would have been involved in that, apart from the guy doing the weather. Everybody else would have been on Barrymore. Yeah, all right, it's tragic, but it's also, well, brilliant, what a brilliant story.
Investigations have been continuing at Michael Barrymore's home in Royden after a man was found unconscious in an outdoor pool, but attempts to revive him failed. He's been named tonight as Stuart Lubbock, who worked as a wholesale butcher's supervisor. A spokesman for Michael Barrymore said he was deeply saddened by the terrible tragedy, and his concern and thoughts were for the young man's family.
Look at your dress.
I love that dress.
Have you still got it?
Yeah.
Have you? Mm. Oh, there I am with my pearl. Here he is. Oh, bless him.
Just keeps moving.
Yeah, he's nervous.
Just all fidgety, yeah.
Hi, Susan, Joanne. Thank you, Stuart.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
To have
a
from this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
Your first love, really, wasn't he?
Mm.
I don't think he wanted to split up, did he? He wanted to try and make it work, and he was heartbroken.
Yeah, he was, weren't he?
Mm.
He was devoted, but he had a lot of attention as well from other people. There was always a lot of females that was interested in him. I think he had a lot of friends with benefits. It's just sad, like, the whole thing.
Yeah.
Getting married young, separating, divorcing, him dying. It's just, like, the whole lot, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's crazy. It's like you don't believe it.
No. No, it did take...
It's just like, what was he... doing that, like,
yeah, why was he there?
Yeah.
Miss Macy, yeah.
He would have just been like starstruck with Barrymore.
They used to say, are you twins? I suppose we were twins in a way. We got home from work that night, and Stuart pumped the music up on the hi-fi that he had, because we were going in. And we go out to this nightclub, same as what we do every week. And who's there? Who's at this nightclub? Stuart was the best brother in the world. It's everything you could want, really. He was my younger brother as well. I was a year older than him, but I did look up to him. Because Stuart had the looks. Stuart had the charm with the girls. And that's, it actually made me a bit jealous. Stuart said to me, Michael Barrymore was in the toilet. And I was thinking, what, Michael Barrymore? Anyway, he came out of the toilet and they're all shaking his hand. They're saying, oh, good on you, Michael. Thanks, Michael. You're the best, Michael. I heard this. And he's coming over in this direction. So I get hold of his hand, say, all right, all right. And I was using his catchphrase. And he said, who are you? And I just smiled at him. Stuart was next to me. And that's the reason why I did it. This woman comes out from somewhere. And she whispers something in Stuart's ear. He went, oh, right, like that. And he shot off and went down those stairs. And I remember looking at him and thinking, oh, right, you're off, are you still? She was actually saying to Stuart, Barrymore's invited people back, you know? It was unbelievable.
Nobody had a problem with Michael Barrymore apart from the fact he liked a drink. That's a well-known fact. It probably was about half or so, something like that in the morning. He came out of the club, walked across the road. He was definitely not walking in a straight line. He was definitely drunk. He had plimsoll type shoes on, jeans, very scruffy. He got in the car. I just went to pull away, so I turned round. A girl got in the front and two guys got in the back, who I now know was Stuart Lubbock, was the one in the middle. Didn't like the situation. I thought they was gatecrashing his house. He wasn't in a fit state to entertain anybody. Well, as I was going round the top bend towards Royden, I felt my headrest move, and it was Michael who was pulling himself up towards my seat, and he put his head next to mine near enough. I went, I could do with a fuck right now. And then he slouched back into his seat. And he was like that until we actually reached the house.
What Stuart wanted when he went back to Barrymore's, he was going to go to work and just say to everybody, oh, you'd never guess where I was in the weekend. That's all he wanted. That's all he wanted. There was a knock at the door, and there were two police. Something inside of me didn't like what they were going to say. I sat in the chair, and they told me. I didn't understand.
It didn't. I couldn't make sense of it. I couldn't grasp the fact that my son was linked with Barrymore. It's consumed me what happened to Stuart. It's my life. Now it's taken over my life.
The immediate assumption for everybody was that the victim was gay. Because who the hell would go home with Michael Barrymore and a group of young men? It certainly seemed to be a pretty nasty gay poolside party. To get an exclusive lineup, you have to outsmart 10 other seasoned Sun and Daily Mirror reporters to find the best story that everyone's going to want to read at the end of the week. So I found out where his mother lived and sent myself out to Essex to interview her. I wasn't the first one there. The camera crew was already set up around her house. The curtains were closed. I mean, she's just been told that her son is dead. When a crime story happens, it really helps to put on a dark blue suit and look a bit like a detective. Just bang on the door and say, "Hello, Paul McMullen, I'm investigating the incident of your son being found in Barrymore's swimming pool." And she'd go, "Okay, what would you like to know?" And I remember I said, "Well, he's not gay, is he? It's outrageous what they're saying about your son being gay." And she immediately went, "Yes, of course he's not gay." She's clearly angry that her son had been branded some way responsible for his own death by the fact that he was gay. And then she said, "Well, which police station are you from?" I said, "Oh, no, I'm a News of the World investigator. Hello, my name's Paul McMullen." I said, "Oh, so..." Slammed the door. But that was enough to give us a good headline.
Everything I was reading didn't sound like Stuart. It just wasn't him that they was talking about. None of it made sense. Most of the papers were saying that he was a gay orgy. Stuart wasn't gay. Stuart, definitely, if you ask any of his work colleagues, friends, family, whoever, everyone would say Stuart wasn't gay.
The budget of my department was 3.1 million a year. We had a lot of money to buy people up. We immediately approached the people at the party. Within just a matter of hours of the body being fished out, we had Barrymore's lover, John Kenny, on the phone himself. We ended up paying him £60,000 to tell us exactly what went on that night. He portrayed himself as the hero of the hour, how he fished the body from the pool and he performed CPR for 25 minutes and talked about his nightmares. There was a dustman called Justin Merritt and we gave him £30,000. I wasn't convinced they told the truth at all. They told what they wanted people to believe, but I don't think, I think it was quite a long way from the truth.
So truth isn't the most important thing here?
No. The fact that the person was there and telling a bucket load of lies didn't matter. Truth does matter, but in this case, it didn't really.
Your overriding concern is someone's lost their lives. Your professional concern is we're going to have to make some judgments. There's clearly so much speculation, so much noise, that the idea that Michael coming on and doing an act and being funny and so on, messing around, didn't feel right. There was a meeting I had with Michael in my office and we suspended the shows. That doesn't mean to say that we were set Michael adrift and say, "Off you pop, we're not going to do anything with you anymore," because we didn't know. We didn't know the facts. Michael was in an impossible position. You're powerless to stop misreporting, distortions of events, stories that the tabloids were determined to hang on him. For an entertainer like Michael, this is corrosive. It's undermining his relationship with the audience.
Good evening, and welcome to this special edition of the Tonight Programme.
Michael thought I should do this interview because my side of the story's not getting across.
What happened when you got home? Can you just take me through the sequence of events?
We agreed we'd go to the jacuzzi, give it a go. Went down to the corner end of the house. I gave them some shorts, they changed, I changed into a pair of shorts. Walked out to the pool towards the jacuzzi, everybody was back in the house by then. And then I looked down, which is effectively the deep end, and Stuart was there.
What did you do?
I just freaked out. I ran back in and got Jonathan, who I know is a lifesaver. And Simon and James jumped in and pulled his body out. It was like some really bad film with not a happy ending. This is somebody I never knew. But it was my house, it was my pool. And I felt responsible for that. I don't know what to say. Some of the papers wrote sex orgy. There was no sex in that house that night. There was no orgy that I was aware of at all. It was totally fabricated. To this day, I don't know what happened to him.
I would have been phoned in the morning to say that a person has been found in a swimming pool and he's dead, and we now need to know what the cause of death is. These are my original diagrams that I made when I examined Stuart. So the first page shows a number of small injuries that I identified. There's small abrasions, injuries you'd get if you removed, or when Stuart was removed from the swimming pool. I look at see if there's any scuffle injuries, restraint injuries, and I could find no injuries that showed that sort of pattern. When I went through the whole post-mortem with the police, it was my opinion that there was no third party involved in the death. As a result of that, it was my opinion, with fluid in the air passages and fluid in the lungs, that this was a case of immersion, as I call it, or drowning.
I wasn't convinced that drowning was the correct cause of death. Even though he was found in water, that does not mean that he has died there. Water can hamper investigations in terms of trace evidence. So we've now got to be confident whether he drowned or not. Dr. Calder is a well-recognised expert on drowning, and that was why he was involved.
Come on, and you, George, come on.
What's he in doing, Dorothy?
Well, he's gone to collect his files. He keeps them in an old shed, locked up in the garden.
I said, I think there may be difficulties and troubles here because it's a high-profile case. They wanted to be sure that this was actually drowning because there was a lot hanging on that. What makes a perfectly fit and healthy chap drown? Stuart's lungs did not show the classical appearances of drowning. They were very heavy, much heavier than one expected, and also they did not appear to be overlapping each other in the chest cavity. Sometimes people inhale stomach contents, but there were no stomach contents as far as I could see. There was no typical froth in the lungs because they'd obviously done some sophisticated resuscitation.
Didn't add up to a classical drowning.
One always, with these cases, one thinks, American expression, think dirty.
There were some findings that were clearly abnormal. There was petechiae present. Petechiae are pinhead-sized hemorrhages you get in the face and the eyes. They occur for a number of reasons, but one of them is that the neck has been compressed. In other words, someone has either been strangled or put in an arm lock.
When I first did my examination, it was apparent there was a lot of blood on the cloth that he'd been wrapped in. And that was around the pelvic region. And that showed that there was extensive hemorrhage from the region of the anus. There was clear dilatation of the anal canal. There were clear injuries around the anus, and those injuries included abrasions, they included bruising, and they included tearing of the anal wall. In the informal setting that we are here, I would describe the injuries to the anus as horrific.
The petechiae and the anal injuries are not simple drowning findings, and therefore they raise concerns that this person did not drown in the pool. Now, it's not my job to tell the police how to do their investigation, but it is my job to tell the police this may not be a drowning, and you should be aware of that.
An inquest into the death of a man found floating in a swimming pool at the home of the television entertainer Michael Barrymore began today.
Now the television star is expected to give his version of events at the inquest into Mr. Lubbock's death.
Coroner has stressed that today's hearing is not a trial. Instead, it's an investigation into the events that took place here at Michael Barrymore's house and an attempt to establish exactly how Stuart Lubbock died.
I'd just come from the regions. I was new to network, and it was my first stab at working in the main newsroom at the BBC. What I remember is the first thing I saw was a wall of photographers. The atmosphere was practically febrile.
Arriving at the opening of today's inquest was the well-known barrister Michael Mansfield. He's been hired by Mr. Barrymore to represent him throughout the proceedings.
Having somebody like Mike Mansfield there was daunting. He'd been involved in the Bloody Sunday inquiries, and he'd helped prosecute the men alleged of killing Stephen Lawrence. It showed that Mr. Barrymore was taking the inquiry very seriously. He wanted someone very experienced in order to put across his account of that night. Terry and the family didn't have the means to pay going rate for representation. So the solicitor and I basically did it for free.
The coroner, Caroline Beasley Murray, told the court this was an inquest into a death and not an inquiry into people's sexual or social activities.
There had been widespread tabloid coverage that there had been some kind of wild gay orgy at the house. When the party guests arrived at the inquest, what became evident very quickly was that they were actually quite a disparate group of people. There was Justin Merritt, his sister Connie Merritt, local to Harlow. They happened to be in the club that night. And then there was Claire Jones and Kelly Campbell, two girls in their teens. They were friends of Kylie's. And then there was Simon Shaw and James Futus. They had a connection to Barrymore. They kind of knew him from a local pub. And then there was Jonathan Kenny. He'd been with Michael Barrymore as his boyfriend for a couple of months. So this is the one opportunity for them to tell the story of what happened that night, where we were going to get as far as possible the facts and not just the tabloid rumours.
Today, the court heard from Kylie Merritt. She told the inquest that she saw Mr. Barrymore rub cocaine into Stuart Lubbock's gums. When asked by the coroner whether Mr. Lubbock appeared unwilling, she replied yes, he had tried to move his head away.
Whilst people were prepared to say, yes, we were there, yes, there was drugs, yes, there was alcohol, there was a void in anybody commenting on where Stuart was or who he was with in the time period up to him being found in the pool. So on their evidence, Stuart's death remained unexplained.
As Michael Barrymore left his home on the way to court, there were still hopes he'd be able to shed more light on the convoluted and conflicting versions of how a young man came to be found dead in his swimming pool.
Michael Barrymore's reputation had been built on being likeable, he was funny, he was trustworthy. People thought that they knew him, so quite obviously, the expectation was that he would come to court, that he would give evidence, and that evidence would be as detailed as possible, that he would almost be as amiable as he was on television. I mean, that isn't actually what happened.
The entertainer Michael Barrymore has refused to answer questions about alleged drug taking at his home on the night a man was found dead in his swimming pool.
He denied rubbing cocaine on the gums of Stuart Lubbock, as two other guests had earlier claimed.
The coroner asked Mr. Barrymore, did you see Stuart in the kitchen with cocaine? I am not prepared to answer that question, said Mr. Barrymore. And when cross-examined by the barrister for the Lubbock family, was it you who rubbed cocaine into Stuart's gums? No, it was not, said Mr. Barrymore.
He refused to answer questions about some significant things. He was allowed to do that. There's nothing wrong with that, but he refused. That in itself generated headlines because it's obviously then his silence, which implies something.
It's very exciting. It was great. I mean, this is a chance to set the news agenda for the week. There's lots of little add-on stories that kept this story going.
I cannot swim, he said, but Simon Shaw and James Footers jumped in.
There was a lot of hoo-ha about why didn't Barrymore jump in and save the boy if he found him floating in his swimming pool. But Barrymore said, I didn't jump in because I can't swim. And various people saying, well, we've seen him swim, so he can swim.
Barrymore told the inquest he couldn't swim. His ex-wife Cheryl says he can.
She's been interviewed by the police in the last couple of days, and she's given them the names and addresses of at least a dozen other people who have swum with Michael Barrymore.
If the allegation was true, it would be a very, very serious matter, yeah. But Mr. Barrymore says he can't swim, and the allegation is untrue.
Michael Barrymore described finding Mr. Lubbock's body. He admitted that after it was pulled from the water, he left the house. He said it was not the right thing to do, but he was in a panicky state.
Mr. Barrymore rifled through some drawers, took some personal possessions, and left before the ambulance arrived.
Why would he run away? It's his house, his pool, his party, and he's run off. Most people would flee the scene because they're guilty as hell.
But the entertainer's barrister complained that tabloid reporting was lurid and unfair. And he says that witnesses who'd been paid for their stories might have been prejudiced.
I've been at the job 30 years, and it's worse now, I think, than it's ever been, because the tabloids themselves have vast sums of money and resources, and I think they don't really care.
One man can produce the truth, Michael Barrymore. He has failed to do so. And for his counsel, his QC, to criticise newspapers in their efforts to produce the truth is frankly outrageous.
This was the biggest story in Britain that year. Biggest story of the decade, crime-wise. Had all the magic ingredients, you know. If anything, I think the story would have been bigger if it had been a sweet, innocent girl who had been found floating in a pool, because there would have been better pictures to come out. People might have felt more sympathy.
Good luck. The single most important person at this inquest was actually Stuart Lubbock. The crucial thing here was to try and understand how a young man, a much-loved son, a brother, had ended up dead.
The difficulty was that even after the second post-mortem examination, there still seemed to be some uncertainty about both the cause of death and the circumstances surrounding Stuart's death. Now, the assumption that he had drowned in the swimming pool, in my view, was based on rather tenuous and rather flimsy evidence. I think where we were agreed was that Stuart had been the victim of a serious sexual assault. The photographs showed a widening of the anal canal, laceration to it, highly suggestive of some large object having been forcibly inserted into the anus. It could have been an attempt at forceful fisting.
A bottle, a dildo, that sort of thing could have caused those injuries.
I was shown a photograph at the police headquarters,
and it shows on the wall of the jacuzzi a Paul thermometer that would have four cutting edges. An object like this, or even this object, could have produced the injuries I identified on Stuart's anus if this had been passed into the anal canal a number of times.
I cannot contemplate any circumstances where this was a consensual act.
Do you think Stuart was raped?
Well, I think that is a very likely scenario.
When Michael Barrymore was asked how these injuries might have been sustained, he said he did not know. He was adamant that they could not have happened at his home.
Michael Mansfield, on behalf of Mr. Barrymore, put a series of suggestions to witnesses to try and run the theory that the injuries might have been occasioned in a different way and not at the property.
Well, the CCTV footage of Stuart Lubbock leaving the nightclub seemed to indicate that he was perfectly fine.
Could it have been an accident? Stuart could have dive-bombed into the pool.
That is an improbable explanation. Dive-bombing into the pool would not cause these injuries.
The injuries might have been occasioned to Stuart during resuscitation by the repeated insertion of the rectal thermometer.
These probes are really only a couple of millimetres diameter. They're rounded at the tip and could not conceivably have caused the injuries.
At no stage through the inquest process did I hear anything from Mr. Barrymore that would lead me to believe there was an acceptance that there had been a serious sexual assault at the house.
This young man had suffered a very violent and very serious sexual assault. So perhaps, from my point of view, I think that would have been the most important aspect of the case. Here we have Stuart with both MDMA and cocaine in his bloodstream, and then this sudden assault. That combination could, in my opinion, very easily have caused him to have a sudden cardiac arrest. To me, that is one very plausible explanation to account for Stuart's death.
Mortem examinations revealed that Stuart Lubbock had suffered serious sexual
injuries.
He suffered
severe internal injuries.
Serious anal injuries. He may have been raped.
That may have contributed to his death.
My dad started pulling his eyes out. They had to get my dad out straight away. The pathologist, he was really adamant, And hopefully that put an end to the theory that, somebody had sex with him. That was my brother.
Why would you rape Stuart? It didn't make sense. And how did he get them injuries so severe that could have killed him? The pain he must have been in.
and it's just hard.
This is the report of the post-mortem. I could keep an eye on them, and they're quite important to me. This underlining was done by me after the inquest. These injuries were indication of a serious sexual assault. They were not, in my view, have been caused by consensual intercourse. Bastards. Fucking bastards. They drugged my son. I hope to God that Stuart was on another planet, that he didn't feel the pain.
A mystery. That's the coroner's verdict at the inquest into the death of a man whose body was found floating in the entertainer Michael Barrymore's swimming pool.
The coroner said none of these witnesses who were party guests have given to this court an explanation about how Stuart Lubbock, a previously fit 31-year-old, should be found floating in a swimming pool at the premises with a significant level of alcohol and drugs in his system and have serious sexual injuries.
When she delivered her open verdict, she made it very clear that the patchy memories of the partygoers that night had done absolutely nothing to establish the facts. You did end up asking yourself how much of this is witnesses feeling they have to hold back. And if they feel they have to hold back, why do they feel they have to hold back?
The learned coroner has today recorded an open verdict. And the family, although disappointed, are pleased that the circumstances in which Stuart met his death have now been made public.
Stuart Lubbock's family left court today deeply dismayed. The coroner said despite intense media interest, they had maintained both dignity and composure.
The overwhelming sense that I had at the end of it was... I just felt incredibly sorry for the Lubbock family. That was it, really. As I do to this day, actually.
If this had been a woman face down in this pool, seriously sexually assaulted, bitterly abused, physically abused, we'd never have seen an outcome like this.
Well, unfortunately, I would refute that. Perhaps you would think naturally so. This investigation has been as thorough as it can be, given the context in which we've been operating. I do have some private views about it, but this open verdict means that I have to be extremely careful about how I articulate those.
So an open verdict essentially means the coroner can't come to a decision about what happened. So it enables, I think, anybody to spin it in whatever way they feel appropriate, consistent with whatever narrative they want to put across. So Mr. Barrymore wants to use that inquest process to try and salvage his life.
Good morning. Michael Barrymore says he has new evidence about the events at his home the night Stuart Lubbock died.
Breaking his silence, Michael Barrymore sat down with GMTV's Fiona Phillips at his luxury hotel in Dubai.
In the last few days, my solicitors managed to locate
one of the nurses who worked on Stuart, and he quite clearly states, without any shadow of a doubt, that when Stuart Lubbock arrived at the A&E department, there were absolutely no injuries whatsoever to his body. He did not receive any injuries at my house at all.
And yet they were definitely there. He did sustain injuries, so if it didn't happen at your house, where could it have happened?
They did not happen at my house.
When Mr. Lubbock's body left Mr. Barrymore's house, medical staff say that there are no injuries on the body. Yet at 4 o'clock in the afternoon when the post-mortem is performed, there are severe and unmissable injuries on the body.
Michael, where does this leave you as regards your career? Do you believe exoneration in this would lead to a revival of your TV career?
To be honest, I'm only here to deal with this. I'm purely here and interested that we can get together with the Lubbocks and the investigation is done right. You know, we should be joining forces to find out what happened to Stuart.
Thank you, Michael. We've got to leave it there. Thank you very much indeed.
Thanks very much indeed.
Your views on Michael Barrymore's situation, text us 81189. We're going to take a short break.
I suppose in his mind what he was doing was appealing to the court of public opinion. But the problem with court of public opinion is that it has no way of handing down a judgment. There's no point trying to convince Fiona Phillips or an unseen part of the ITV audience that you're innocent, because neither of them can give you innocence.
We'd like to ask you this question. Michael Barrymore has not been found guilty of any crime, but do you want to see him on television ever again?
His particular difficulty was that he wasn't guilty of anything, but nor was he innocent of anything. To vanish would be seen as an admission of guilt.
We just received a statement from Essex Police. They've reviewed the investigation into the death of Stuart Lubbock, and in view of an additional line of inquiry suggested by Michael Barrymore, a further investigation will be launched based on the suggestion that the injuries to Stuart Lubbock were caused at the Princess Alexandra Hospital.
Think those injuries were sustained? What's your suspicion?
If I start saying my suspicions on things like that, then I think that would be totally wrong. That's for the police to investigate. I have my views on it and thoughts, obviously.
How might this affect your career?
I have no way of knowing. It's not in my hands what I do. If somebody wants to use me, they use me. If the public want me, they'll watch.
Today, Stuart Lubbock's family said they wanted every possible line of inquiry followed up.
It must be spelt out, but the facts will be the same.
Meanwhile, Michael Barrymore says not only is he now ready to work again, he says there are offers on the table.
If I was to say to you how many months before you're back on telly, Michael, what would you say?
4, 5 months, 6 months.
He says 4, 5, 6 months. Can you see it happening, Barrymore on telly?
I think everyone would like to see Barrymore back on TV, because when he's on form, he's brilliant. Yes. You know, the British public are a pretty forgiving bunch.
An ITV executive at the time told me that one of the issues in whether to bring back Michael Barrymore was that an astonishing number of ITV adverts begin with a shot of a swimming pool. It seems odd, but of course that is true, because so much of the advertising is holiday related. But imagine Barrymore comes back on ITV, he says, we'll be back after this, and then you just see a succession of pictures of swimming pools.
At the peak of his fame, Michael Barrymore was watched by millions, but he's making his comeback in front of an audience of just a few hundred. This was a rehearsal, but he's hoping the show's 7-week run in the West End will restore his public reputation and allow him to step back into the limelight.
Coming back onto stage, it was a risk, wasn't it, that although you're entirely legally innocent, there was a fear, there must have been, that scandal is now a shadow, that it's harder for people to laugh at you. Did that worry you?
I can't go on stage and take that on stage with me, and there's no way I do.
But you don't worry that people see you differently now because of all that stuff they've read in papers about you?
Well, I mean, yeah, but if they believe what they read, would they come in the first place?
I sat through it with sweating palms and a knot in my stomach, and the audience was not with him. There was a point when he said to the band, look, you star, I'll come in, it doesn't matter if we don't finish together, because frankly, no one here cares. And it was true, nobody actually did.
You cannot maintain the polite fiction that you're out for an evening of light entertainment. You realize you were watching a desperate man.
To me, he felt the audience were withholding their warmth and laughter. They were judging him. So one of his great calling cards, which was his rapport with the audience, disappeared. We would have been showing the interview on the Friday night and then discussing it. And on the Thursday, as I remember, they announced that the theatre run had been abandoned. They'd cancelled the whole theatre show.
Say they've taken evidence from 16 people, including pathologists and staff at the hospital. Detectives are satisfied injuries to Stuart Lubbock occurred before he died.
The thought of any interference with the body when it's in the mortuary, I couldn't accept for the simple reason. One is the body is wrapped up, and it was wrapped up when I was there present. And the other is that you've actually got bruising and tearing and bleeding from the anus. And if you were dead, that would not happen.
When you find bruising, it indicates that the person is still alive and their heart is still beating. So there's no doubt that he was still alive when those injuries were sustained. In my opinion, Stuart Lubbock sustained those injuries at Michael Barrymore's house. I think they've occurred shortly before his death.
The theory that this was essentially necrophilia, I think, is a fanciful explanation.
Were you surprised that the medics didn't notice the injuries to Stuart's anus?
No, not at all. It's quite common forensic pathologists to pick up injuries that are not identified by clinicians, and that's why you do post-mortem examinations, because we find things that other people don't.
ITV has dropped Michael Barrymore, who used to be one of its biggest stars. The network isn't renewing his contract and won't be making any more programmes with him.
Now the entertainer's trying new life in New Zealand, far away from the scandal.
I have to say, it was a relatively straightforward judgment to make. What kind of career did he have left anyway? He was a unique talent, and that unique talent didn't work anymore against the context of what happened that night. That's it. So it was the end.
I'm a campaign publicist, trying to get to the truth by the use of publicity. You've got to have the right characters and players to work with. If you haven't got them, you're going to hide into nothing. And with Terry, he's a great character.
How's your tea going down?
Yeah, it's lovely.
His cause is second to none. The first meeting with Terry, seeing him face to face, a father that lost a son, and I thought, this guy needs help.
Who killed Stuart Lubbock at Michael's house?
I have to take credit for that one. The simple ideas are often the best, aren't they? I think it cost a tenner.
Quite simply, those anal injuries led to my son's death.
Terry was on his own. He was the only person within that Lubbock family that really was prepared to do battle. He was getting coverage in the local press, but we had to have the front page stories. We had to keep the pressure on. What we were after was the second police investigation. Michael Barrymore was the hook. Without him, you know, probably going nowhere, is it? You know, it's not going to go anywhere with Justin Merritt or Jonathan Kelly. They're not the stars, you know. The star is Michael Barrymore. We were actually thinking about going to New Zealand with Terry, confronting Barrymore there. And little did we know that Barrymore was planning to come back.
This is where the fun really starts. Please welcome housemate number two. It's Michael Barrymore!
Michael was always desperate to come back to TV. It consumed him, and I think he felt very lost. He saw this as a way of redeeming himself, maybe getting forgiveness from the public. Oh. The Sun's coverage was very negative about him. The dead body, he should be in jail. He fled the scene, he fled the country. What's he doing on telly?
Michael Barrymore may be firmly ensconced in the Big Brother house up there, which you can see in the distance, but out here in the real world, a storm is brewing.
We had an opportunity here. The game was on, wasn't it? It was all about publicity, basically upstaging Michael Barrymore's appearance.
We head straight over the road to the gatehouse at Big Brother house.
We clearly thought, you know, that they're going to let us in, and, yeah, of course, it didn't quite work that way. They didn't want us there, did they? We had all the security there. They were in panic mode. No, no, you're not coming in.
The show's producers, unsurprisingly, didn't allow Mr. Lubbock to meet Michael Barrymore in person. Mr. Barrymore, of course, hoped that his appearance in this show would prove something of a resurrection in his fortunes, but tonight it appears that his past has come back to haunt him.
You're a trembling bird, I can see, and
you're
sad eyes.
I'm fed up with being kicked around like a bleeding ball all the time.
Yeah,
I've had
nobody's mop.
If I was guilty of anything, I'm the one who's got an answer to me first, right?
Yeah.
I have to be honest with me first. And no, I haven't done nothing. I haven't hurt anybody.
As it went on, the public were actually warming to him.
Who here likes Michael and thinks he's fantastic? This young lady's very keen.
I just feel really sorry for him. I just want to go in there and give him a big hug. He just needs a hug and some love.
The thing is, though, Michael Barrymore is one of the greatest entertainers this country's ever produced. Oh, let's be honest about it. He is. And he got a bit over his head. He made a few mistakes, like we've all done. We've all done things a bit naughty that we shouldn't have done in the past. And at the end of the day, it takes a lot of guts to come back to a country that ate him.
I got it.
He was very funny. We were getting phone calls from the readership that, you know, they love this man and they want him back in their lives. For a newspaper, to then say, well, you know, we're going to carry on writing horrid stories, you know, it's not a good business decision, really, is it?
Hello, darling.
Hello.
I think Michael Barrymore is magic. As far as I know, he wasn't found guilty.
Yeah.
And this is a wonderful opportunity for him to come out and face the public. He's showing everyone that he's a fighter.
Guess what? We have a winner. And you chose them.
Oh.
You are live.
The paper flipped to, well, actually, let's talk about more about Michael and the good things about Michael.
Michael, you have finished second. Please leave the Big Brother house.
My deputy editor called me in and said we were going to be doing a big buy-up with Michael when he left the house. He came out on a real high. He really, really was so excited. I think he felt this was it. My role was to go down and talk it all through, and the deal was around 50,000.
It's quite something, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, I'm blown away, honestly.
The paper wanted a meeting between Michael and Terry as a big part of the buy-up. I think Terry was paid 2,000.
They said I had the chance of meeting Michael Barrymore. Are you up for that? I said, of course. We drove to where Michael Barrymore was staying. Big hotel, top drawer place.
We'd agreed with both of them that the meeting between them for an hour would be private. I just remember us all standing outside the corridor, pacing up and down. How's this going to go? And we were expecting fireworks. We thought we'd hear raised voices. And then we started to hear laughter.
He was a nice guy. I couldn't believe how matey he was. He kept jawing about his life, where he'd been, for about an hour. I think I'll put up with this. And I said, Michael, we've got to get down to what happened to my son.
Do you feel like you got any answers from that meeting?
No. It was small talk.
Terence Lubbock, ushered by his son, Newspaper Minders, is back in Harlow today after an extraordinary weekend. He came face to face with Michael Barrymore, and the two spoke for the first time about the tragedy that has marred both their lives for the last 5 years.
I don't blame you, Michael.
Did you feel like you'd been sort of turned over?
No, not at all. Forgive Michael, whatever. It's still the front page, you know. In the bigger picture, it was a good idea.
I thought you met with Michael Barrymore to try and sort out something.
I have indeed, but I'm afraid that was Barrymore's ball game entirely, and I was putting my head in the lion's mouth, so to speak. I was taking a chance, and it was really speaking, it was a total sass up on Barrymore's side.
I think Michael had always wanted to do it. He'd always wanted to speak to this man. It was like a laying of a ghost, really. Now he was going to go back on telly and become a big star again.
We can sing.
My name is Michael Barrymore, and I'm thrilled to be here.
Don't you start.
I think he really thought he was going to get another TV show.
Barrymore is definitely back.
And then wham, suddenly, you know, it's announced by Essex Police. They're going to reinvestigate it all. Okay,
Michael. Thank you.
Michael Barrymore says he welcomes a new investigation into the death of a man whose body was found at his Essex home 5 years ago.
Yeah, you're recording? Yeah. So I'm going to read it because I just want to be precise about it as well. And then we'll take it from there, if you don't mind. Is that OK with you?
That's absolutely fine.
Fine, thank you. I do hope the police have made a breakthrough. I sincerely do. This story has been too seductive in the past, and I have had to endure extraordinary and preposterous accusations. And perhaps now the media, particularly the tabloids, will consider their tone and also try to consider the proper facts. Rather than heating up sensation and innuendo. Okay.
First of all, the first question, just on some of the press coverage today, there are reports in the News of the World and allegations of a cover-up in the house that night and a suggestion that maybe Mr. Lubbock hadn't drowned at all. What's your response to those claims?
Well, my response to those claims is that it's absolutely preposterous, and that is changing the whole spectre of what happened at all. I mean, the police investigated it. There is no evidence to support that whatsoever.
We're actually at the cemetery where Stuart's buried, filming for tonight's programme. got a phone call from Essex Police saying that they arrested three guys on the suspicion sexual assault, rape and murder of Stuart Lubbock.
Once he was an A-list celebrity, tonight he is a murder suspect. Michael Barrymore and two others have been questioned by police over the death of Stuart Lubbock.
They're also suspected of serious sexual assault.
John Kenny and Justin Merritt are also being held. The police here say that they do have 18 new leads, and they say that they're determined to get to the bottom of what happened to Stuart Lubbock.
Hey, mate.
Yep.
Mobbed by reporters and camera crews, Stuart Lubbock's father, Terry, arrived back at the family home.
Are you pleased about the arrest?
Very pleased.
It was as if he'd won the lottery that day. He was highly elated. He thought we were actually getting somewhere now, and this was a major turning point.
I don't think it's hit me at this moment in time, and I feel like I'm on pause, and I'm waiting for the charge. That's the goal. Then my job will be done.
Michael Barrymore has been held for questioning at Harlow Police Station all day.
Essex police have been given a further 12 hours to question Michael Barrymore and two other men.
Michael is fully cooperating with the police in their inquiries. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
And we waited and waited, and next thing, Barrymore's released with the two others, Merritt and Kenny. Not good.
Michael Barrymore slipped out of Harlow Police Station, apparently hiding inside the back of this black Mercedes. For Essex Police, the case remains an unsolved murder.
The CPS, the Crown Prosecution Service, has adjudicated that there is currently insufficient evidence to proceed against any of the individuals for either Stuart's death or his injuries.
I blame the police. The police at the scene messed up so big.
We did make mistakes early on in terms of the crime scene because a lot of the witnesses were saying that they thought it was a drowning, a tragic accident. We probably believed it at that point.
The first police on the scene did not do their job properly, an independent investigation has established. The damning report says that blood found on Stuart Lubbock's boxer shorts, towels and a robe was not promptly investigated.
An apology won't bring his son back, but the admission by Essex Police that they bungled the investigation into Stuart Lubbock's death provided some satisfaction for his father, Terry.
I'm afraid they've let me down big time and they've let my son down big time.
Yeah, I mean, I am the fifth SIO that's been involved in this case. My responsibility now is to review the evidence, to move it forward. The scene was secured, but not to the standard that we would expect. Hence the reason that people were allowed back in there. Then we know that items are now gone missing. Throughout the investigation, there have been suggestions there was a cover-up. Michael Brown, who was Michael Brownwell's PA at the time, was wrongfully allowed back into the scene where he was seen to be tidying up some items. After we'd managed to photograph the scene, those items had gone missing and we'd never seized them. It was a handle from a cupboard from an outhouse and also a pool thermometer.
So what's your explanation on it?
That they've been removed to hide evidence. Stuart was assaulted quite possibly in the jacuzzi and then either died in the jacuzzi or went unconscious and then, to make it look like a drowning, thrown in the swimming pool. I believe very much that Stuart Lubbock was raped and murdered that night. Somebody at that party knows what happens. That is completely and utterly a fact. The key to bringing people to justice definitely sits with the eight people that were there.
The entertainer Michael Barrymore is at the High Court this afternoon claiming compensation from Essex Police. The 65-year-old claims his arrest on suspicion of rape and murder a decade ago had a devastating impact on his career and earnings.
Who are you?
I'm Joe Mander from ITV London.
Hello, ITV London.
Hi.
Hello, Joe Mander.
Are you happy with what's been decided?
I was really confused at a lot of it, to be quite honest, but...
Michael Barrymore's legal team say that the case against him was weak at best. They had no right to make that arrest in the first place.
What's your name?
I'm Nick.
Well, I think I've been on the scene. Right, little Dan.
BBC Five Live.
Let's get the latest BBC news then on Five Live. Michael Barrymore will only get nominal damages. He was hoping for a payout of more than £2 million. Essex Police challenged the amount and won its appeal.
It's a great day for Terry, a bad day for Michael Barrymore.
Good.
How you doing, mate? All right?
Yeah.
Good to see you.
How you doing?
Fantastic, mate.
You looking well?
Not too bad, sorry. It wasn't a good move for Barrymore to start this whole thing off.
No.
What's come out in open court as well, there's things there we didn't know about, we know about now.
Oh, yeah. The shit has hit the fan.
The shit has certainly hit the fan. and it's good to see you smiling again anyway, mate.
Ah.
This is Lord Leveson's judgment from the court case.
Yeah.
There was reasonable grounds both to suspect Mr. Barrymore of committing an offence and it was necessary to arrest him. Essex Police produced a window of opportunity report. This consisted of an analysis of the movements of those in the house to ascertain who had the time and the opportunity to have been responsible for Mr. Lubbock's death. It identified a time when Mr. Barrymore left his bedroom to fetch swimming shorts as the last opportunity before Mr. Lubbock was found in the pool.
Fucking hell. Are they still in the water? Like, we've got him out. You've got to know that. We've been able to do any resuscitation on him. Is he breathing?
No, it ain't working. I don't know how long he's been there.
The judgment is clear. The other two men capable of the attack on Stuart are Barrymore's ex-boyfriend, Jonathan Kenny, and Justin Merritt.
There's a party going on and someone's just gone out and banged.
The judge concluded that there was clear evidence of a violent, penetrating assault which may have been anal rape of a straight man. And Mr. Barrymore was one of only three men who could have committed that assault. That's dynamite.
Yeah.
These are facts that Barrymore cannot hide behind any more.
Sorry, it's a bit weird. Just like I put my back to this, like, you know. Oh, they're French. Hello. Bonjour, what's he called? Bonjour, je te. Piers Morgan, Barrymore, dodgy geezer.
Talk me through what happened that night. People were drinking, taking drugs.
They're all having drinks. They said, oh, can we go in the jacuzzi? So I said, yeah, I've got to put the lights on, because otherwise you won't see where you're going. And then I went out there and had a joint, and as we walked out, I looked down, and there's a steward floating in the pool. And whether it's floating, when you see that, it's a very surreal thing to see.
But let me ask you this, Michael. How do you think Stuart died?
I think he drowned.
Can't believe it, can you? You could just can't believe it.
That family deserve proper answers, OK? No parent should have to bury their young. I had nothing to do with what happened to Stuart, and I have to live in hope that somehow, somewhere, there will be an answer.
Just one wall of silence. And nobody will come forward. From that day, so yes. I just want to move on and just get on with my life. I'm just hoping that somebody might come up with a clue as to what happened there that night.
It's not about Stuart anymore. He's been completely lost in this story. But it's just about Barrymore. The stories that are getting told that are not true.
If I try hard, I can think of Stuart as a child, as a person, as a man. If I try hard, but it's very, very hard, because this thing is so big that it smothered everything that was good about my son, Stuart. I feel exhausted. I feel exhausted. But it is still in me to carry on. How can a father dismiss the questions that have got to be answered about my son's murder? So peaceful. I love you, Stuart. I love you very much.
support information can be found online at channel4.com/support.